Hello, folks. You're gonna like this one. And if you're a groovy cat like I am, you're gonna make good use of this guy. This episode, we're gonna talk about the ladder filter, okay? It's worth the watch, and you should use this and not this. Well, I shouldn't say that. You use whatever you want, but I'm gonna show you why this is the sexiest filter of our time, okay? All right. Okay, so the ladder is just another filter. It was made by Moog or Moog back in the day, and it's not a perfect algorithm, okay? And by that, I mean this one is perfect. If I set it so that we listen to our happy Indian man again. Okay, but judging by this slope here or this slope there, it's not gonna let anything pass the end of that slope. So if I'm starting here and it goes down to there, it's killing all those frequencies, where this one doesn't necessarily do that, but that's kind of what gives it character, what makes it a little bit more sexy than this one, right? Like, let me think. This one is like, this one's like a brand new catcher's mitt, where it's like, oh, that looks good, and it's brand new and shiny. But this one here is worn in, and it does the job really well, okay? That's a terrible example. But anyway, all right. So I know a lot of you probably are getting intimidated just looking at all these knobs and knowing that it's still just a filter. But let's divide it up right here on this line, okay? And let's ignore this half and let's look at this half right there. And when you look at this half in comparison to a regular filter, it's pretty much the same. There's frequency, resonance, resonance, pre, pre, post, post, okay? And then of course in the drop down menu you have four different low pass options right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and in here you only have two, okay? Here you have four different high pass options, and here you only have two, okay? I'll say this, these ones are a lot steeper of slopes, or they're a lot harsher cutoffs than these ones are here, but here you get four different options and here you only get two. And then of course you have your band pass, which is like this guy right there. You got your peak, which is like more like that guy. And then of course your notch, which is that guy right there. But also you have these three interesting ones, which is a high pass to a low pass. And I'll explain those to you, because there's not much other things in Bitwig that have this going on, and it's super cool, okay? All right, so let's just start with a low pass filter for now. Okay, so typically, let me turn this off, you have your typical low pass filter. Let's listen. Right? And you can do your filter opens the way you always do with music nowadays. And it all works the same. You got your pre and your post if you need to play with those at all. And that's basically that as far as the filter is concerned. It's worth noting that it's not a perfect low pass filter, whereas it's still going to let some weird airy stuff kind of come up in the sound. But that's kind of what makes it a little bit sexy sounding too, right? Okay. Now, an interesting feature of this is, like I said, these high pass to low pass features. So now let's have a listen, and I'll start low. So what does it sound like it's happening right now? Well, I'll tell you, what's happening is it's starting at a high pass filter, and at some point it crosses over into being a low pass filter. And that's kind of cool, because you can't do a typical sweep with this one, but it, you know, it just sounds neat. Let's have a listen. Right, so it's still a high pass here, because you're getting all the low frequencies and none of the highs. And now it's bringing up, it's switched over, and now all you hear are the high frequencies until eventually there's nothing to be heard at all. Okay? All right, so that's basically what those are. But let's stick to low pass filter for now. The other interesting thing right here is that you get a key input on a filter, right? Isn't that strange? Well, it's kind of cool, actually. So here you'll see I've created an instrument, there's no device on it, and I've just thrown some notes in here. Where the notes are as far as pitch has no effect on this. This is strictly just worrying about where they are in time, okay? And the transient of them, which they're just MIDI notes, so that's how they're hitting. and it's just random, and I just kind of pressed three and I just drew in some notes like that. Okay, let's not put them too close together. Okay, so now I've taken this and I've used it as my key input, instrument two. All right, now if I turn up the ADSR, because that's what this is and that's what's reading the key input, and this knob is delineating how much of an effect is that going to have on my filter. So now what you'll notice is every time a note is read inside this MIDI track, it's going to affect the ADSR as far as the attack, the delay, the sustain and release. Okay, so let's have a listen. So you'll notice every time it passes one of these notes, it opens up, right? And then decays a little bit. So it's exactly the same as me turning on this guy, clicking this, opening the automation lane here, and then wherever there's a note, I can go in and draw something like that. Like, obviously that's not perfect, but it's the exact same. Okay, so, right? And it's just like me doing that for every time there's a note here, I draw one of those in. And it's the exact same. And I wouldn't want to do that. I'd much rather just use this, right? And I can change the shape of this depending on how I want it drawn. So if I had something like that going on, the automation lane would look a little more like this. Right? And if I turn this up, it might look a little more like this. Right? Because now it's sustaining a little bit. And you get the point. You know what an ADSR is and what it does. But basically, that's the reason why you would have a key input, is to read that and kind of automate how the filter opens and closes. And then it down here, if you go in the other way, it has the exact opposite effect. Let's listen. So interesting, right? Because that kind of creates one of those sidechain inputs. It's just like sidechaining a filter or using a compressor to sidechain, you know, from your kick drum. It's kind of the same way, except using a filter, which I happen to like a lot more, actually. It's a much nicer, kind of cooler sound, right? And it's just more of a, it's just a more groovy way to do it than the typical throw a compressor on there and sidechain it like every Ableton user has been doing for since it came out, right? I'm not knocking Ableton, I still love it, I'm just saying. Okay, all right, so down here you have your LFO, and then you have LFO here. And of course you can see by this gray line, it goes up to frequency. So this is saying, how much is the LFO gonna affect my frequency? And this light is just showing how fast the how fast the rate is of this line here. Okay, so let's listen. And that's as fast as it goes. I'll turn that down so nobody has a seizure. But basically, that's all it is. A very simple LFO. And it's, you turn this up to, you know, choose how much of an impact that has on your frequency, whether it has a full impact or just a little bit. And of course, you can double click it to get it back to center or have an opposite effect. And then the phase is typical phase. It's just basically choosing where on this slope do you want to start the wave. Okay, and then of course you have all your different waves. You got randoms and saws and squares, triangles and whatnot. Okay, and I believe this, so every time it hits a note, it just repeats or restarts the cycle, or if it just moves freely on its own, which is how the default comes. Okay, and then you've got your envelope follower. So now the envelope follower is not using the envelope of the ADSR. That's a different ADSR. It's a different envelope following instrument two. The envelope follower is following the track that this is on. So in this case, that. So pay attention to this light as we play. See that? That light is blinking completely directly proportional to the transients of this track, which is the track we have our ladder on. So now I can use this envelope follower and turn it up all the way, and I can choose the attack, and basically what's going to happen is every time an attack comes in from the audio that we're playing on, it's going to slowly open the filter and then close it again depending on the release, okay? And then of course you can double click it to turn it off. Okay, so that's basically it. If you think about the LFO, it's really just the same as me clicking plus, throwing in, where is it, LFO, and then modulating the frequency. Okay, same thing as that, right? And then the envelope follower is the same as me clicking that and putting in an envelope follower, clicking that and modifying this. Okay, it's the exact same thing as that. The only difference is this sounds sexier than a regular filter, and it's a lot cooler to use. And if we're given tools like this, because really this is a proprietary, filter to Moog, okay? And we shouldn't technically have this, but we do. Bitwig somehow gotten it, and they've given it to us, and we should definitely make use of it because nobody else is going to be using this, okay? And that's just really what it's all about. Okay, kids, I hope that did something for you. Please subscribe to my videos. I would sure love that if you did. If you have any more comments, questions, or anything to add, leave them in the comment section below. Of course, like always, you can email me anytime you want. And we'll see you in the next video. All right? Okay. Take care.